Hey there, Brainiacs. Allie Astrocyte here. As you probably already know, I'm not just a smiling face on YouTube. I'm also an active scientist studying cellular neurobiology. I'm also an American with family members coping with a variety of medical and mental health conditions. So issues that directly affect how scientific research is conducted and how that leads directly to advancing medicine are really important to me. That's why we recently made a couple of videos talking about the president's proposed budget cuts that would reduce NIH funding, and highlighting the way scientists here at UC San Diego and across the country are using government funding. Here at Neurotransmissions, we were happy to see that Congress rejected those cuts, and in fact gave the NIH an additional $2 billion in funding for 2017. Woohoo! But unfortunately, it doesn't end there. The president's updated budget proposal for 2018 plans to cut $6 billion in NIH funding. That's almost 20% of its total budget. Members of the administration are defending these cuts by saying that it won't affect direct research funding, but will instead target overhead payments. They say that these fees paid to universities and institutions are inefficient and wasteful. But overhead payments aren't waste. They're actually literally what keep the lights on. Can I get a little more funding? Thank you. Trying to justify major cuts to the NIH budget by saying that it'll simply reduce indirect costs shows a fundamental misunderstanding of how American scientific research and business in general works. So today, let's talk about what lawmakers mean when they say overhead costs and what that money is actually paying for. See, when scientists receive NIH funding for research, that money pays for a bunch of different things. First and foremost, the majority of the funding, over 70%, goes toward direct costs. This covers pretty much everything that you would intuitively guess that a grant would pay for. It pays for salaries for lab personnel, buys equipment and supplies, and funds travel to conferences to share data and collaborate with colleagues. This is the money that the individual investigator, the person who submitted the grant, spends on the research project that they proposed in their application. On top of that, researchers receive money that goes toward overhead expenses, called facilities and administrative, or F&A, costs. Since scientists can't just do their research in their own garage, they have to work within a university or institution. And just like a bakery or a bank, the scientist has to pay for that space. These F&A costs are what allow the scientist and the university to work together to provide the necessary environment and resources for top-notch scientific research. Facilities costs pay for things you might take for granted, like utilities, internet service, animal housing and care, janitorial staff, data storage, waste disposal security, and various other expenses related to maintaining and running a research facility. Administrative costs cover a lot of the important paperwork and safety regulations of the institution, like chemical safety training, implementing policies to protect human participants and research animals, tracking grant budgeting and purchasing, providing mandated training resources, and all of the things that are needed to keep research facilities in compliance with federal regulations. All of those resources cost money, and research institutions rely on federal funding to help cover those costs to make sure that research is conducted safely and ethically while producing the best results possible. Defenders of the new budget cut have pointed out that while private philanthropic organizations usually only pay about 10% in overhead costs, the federal government generally pays more, usually around 30%. Why should the government pay so much, the argument goes, when private groups pay so little? But these numbers don't come out of a hat. Individual universities and facilities negotiate directly with the US government through the Office of Management and Budget to determine what their overhead payments should be. Federal overhead costs can range from 20% to 85% of the direct costs to account for differences in the cost of doing business in different cities and states. And these rates have to adhere to federal accounting regulations. And this funding is really critical because federal funding has traditionally paid for the majority of biomedical research. In the 60s and 70s, the government funded over 70% of American science before rates began dropping off, reaching an all-time low of 44% in 2015. As federal funding has dropped, research institutions have started to make up some of the difference because private organizations just don't provide enough funding on their own. They only make up a fraction of the money being spent on research. Basically, because of the way the research system has been set up, universities have to rely on federal funding of overhead costs to be able to afford everything they need. Private organizations don't provide enough funding to make up the difference. It's already been a struggle for many institutions. Even though it's gotten more expensive to do research in America, over the last two decades, the level of overhead payments has remained consistent. So universities are footing more and more of the F&A bill on their own. This means higher tuition for students, lower salaries for staff, and, unfortunately, slowing the speed of research. Without any system in place to help shift the expense and burden of F&A costs, a blanket 10% cap on overhead payments would make it incredibly difficult for researchers to continue their work. It's pretty hard to handle dangerous chemicals if your safety equipment isn't functioning. And it's difficult to make sure research animals are being properly cared for, if you can't afford to hire people to care for them. So even though overhead costs sounds kind of nebulous, this funding has a really important and vital place in supporting American scientific research. It's important for scientists, lawmakers, and the public to keep having conversations about the ways we can make research more efficient to quickly develop new medical treatments and cures. But it'll take time and careful analysis to figure out the best approach. America has been a world leader in science and technology for decades, and if we continue to support the NIH and American scientists through increased funding and public awareness, we can keep up this great tradition for generations to come. That's what will truly build a foundation for American greatness. If you'd like to help make sure that scientists can keep the lights on, there are a few things that you can do. First, call your congressional representatives and ask them to help American science grow and thrive by pushing to increase NIH funding, not cutting it. You can also share this video on social media to help your friends and family learn about the importance of overhead payments. Finally, if you're able, consider donating to an organization like the Foundation for the National Institute of Health, a nonprofit organization dedicated to supporting the NIH's scientific mission, or the American Association for the Advancement of Science, who are working to encourage lawmakers and taxpayers to support scientific research funding. Head down to the description for more resources, a calling script, and information about how to contact your representative. Finally, I'd like to say a huge thank you to Andrea Hartzell, Natalie Goldberg, and Gabriel Pratt, who are all biomedical scientists at UC San Diego, for their help with this video. They are all vocal advocates for science in America and are hard at work developing more resources for scientists and students to get involved in science policy here at UCSD. Thanks for watching this episode of Neurotransmissions. If you liked it, please hit that thumbs up button and subscribe to catch more videos about the ins and outs of scientific research. If you really loved it, please consider supporting us on Patreon. Your support is what makes these videos possible. Until our next transmission, I'm Allie Astrocyte. Over and out.